assume so the subject of this lecture is asana, which is a very common and familiar and popular part of yoga. Rather, most of the people think that yoga is asana and asana is yoga. And many are practicing regularly asanas every day and enjoying the results. You are also practicing asanas, you are also getting good results. The question is why the lecture is arranged on asanas now? Because I am not going to explain any particular asana, neither I am asking you to practice the asana. So you have to listen something about asana. And that something is a totally theoretical part of asana. And an ancient reference I am going to give. Patanjali's reference, what Patanjali said about asanas. Because Patanjali has written the basic text on yoga about 2500 years ago. And there he has mentioned some specific points about asana which every yoga practitioner must know before practicing asanas. So with this lecture you will find some change in your practice of asana also. Some system, the procedure may change. So let us start now. The first very important point I would like to mention is yogasana is not exertion, but it's a relaxation. So it's not an exercise. It looks like exercise because in any exercise we make the movements of our body in different systems. So people may call it, or they call it asanas as a yogic exercise. Asana is yogic, but not exercise. It is exactly opposite to exercise. In exercise, there is an exertion to our body, particularly the muscular system. In asanas, it's a relaxation to the muscular system. So totally different results are there. So let us compare between exercise and asana. If you consider the movements, in exercise there are all dynamic movements are there. They have to be. But yogasanas, they are steady. In exercise, they are speedy also. It's not slow. But asana is very, very slow. You can say that it's just like slow motion picture. And they are means they should be. That is what we have to remember. The muscle actions, they are isotonic in exercises, isometric in asanas. I will explain this particular term after this comparison. Because of all this, isotonic movements, speedy movement, dynamic movements, the heart rate increases in any exercise. Exercise may be jogging, running, athletic, gymnasium, or any sports, whatever it is. Because of speedy and dynamic movements, heart rate increases, and nothing is wrong there. Please note, I don't want to blame exercise while comparing asanas. I am just having the comparison. Exercise, heart rate is bound to increase, and that is not risky also. Within certain limits, heart rate can go up, no harm in there. But just to compare, as a comparison, in yogasanas, heart rate decreases. It is increase and decreases with reference to the normal value. Normal heart rate is 72 beats per minute. In exercise, it increases 80, 90, 100, 120 beats per minute also. And when we stop exercise, it comes down. It's a natural reaction of our body. But in asanas, it should go below 72. Maybe 70, 68, 66, or even 60 also. That is why I am saying it's exactly opposite. If you consider respiration rate, the similar results are there. In exercise, it increases. Asanas, it is decreasing. Whether it should decrease, that we have to remember in mind. That during asanas, our heart rate should reduce, respiration rate should reduce. Respiration rate is about 18 breaths per minute. In exercise, it goes to 20, 22, 24, 30, 35 also. In asana, that should reduce, then lower than 18, maybe 17, 16, 15, 14, 12, 10, like that. Similar case with the blood pressure also. In exercise, blood pressure increases because exercise demands more blood. And so the blood pressure, heart rate, respiration rate increases. But all these three parameters are decreasing in asanas because it is not exertion, it is relaxation. And BMR, that is basic metabolic rate, it's a very complicated medical term. It's very difficult to understand right now. But we can say it's a parameter of the body function. So it increases in exercise, decreases in asanas. So most of the body parameters, they are going below the normal range in asanas, and they are going above the normal range in exercises. Exercises are also good, they are also essential, they also have got some good results. While comparing asana and exercise, I don't want to blame exercise. But I want to give a clear picture that asana is not exercise, rather it should not be practiced as exercise, it should be practiced as relaxation. The one term I would like to explain in detail, that is muscle action in asanas and in exercises. Isotonic actions of muscles, where tone is constant and length changes. If you consider the physiology of any muscle of our body, skeletal muscle in particular, it elongates and contracts. That is the function of any muscle. So during the exercise, the length is changing and tone is constant. Tone means load put up on that muscle is tone. For example, you are lifting the weight. Maybe 50 kg. So lifting the weight like this with bar and all that. So we lift the weight in this position. So we are moving our hand with weight. So tone in our muscles is 50 kg. It is constant. Weight is constant. And we are changing the length. As we make the movement, the length is changed. So these are all exercises. Every exercise, if you are running also, weight put up on the muscles of the legs is your weight, it is constant, but you are always changing the length for every step. So in all exercises, muscle action is isotonic, it is called isotonic. And in asanas, it is the reverse way. So it is isometric, where the tone is changing and length is constant. And changing in a sense, tone is reducing. And length is constant. Suppose you have attained a posture, particular posture. Maybe Paschimottanasana, forward bending posture. You bend forward, hold your toes with the fingers and keep it for some time. So when you attain a posture, the muscles length is changed, but that is during attainment. But when you maintain the posture, you are supposed to relax all the muscles. So when you relax the muscles, the tone is reduced. But length is not changed because the position is not changed. So this is how the asanas are practiced. So this is, length is constant, tone is changing. Changing means reducing in asanas. So it is isometric action. And now what is the result of these actions? You see, red muscle fibers are active during isometric actions. Our muscle contains fibers. Fibers are just like rubber bands. So we can say muscle is a bunch of rubber bands. But there are two types of muscle fibers. One is red muscle fiber. Some of them are red, some of them are white. And these red muscle fibers, they consume less oxygen. That is why they look red, because blood is red. Oxygen is reduced, then blood color changes. And white muscle fibers are also there. They are active in isotonic actions, and they consume excess oxygen. That is their quality. So you can know from this also, because red muscle fibers are active in isometric action, that is in asanas. If you maintain the posture and relax, so less oxygen is required. That is why the respiration rate, blood pressure and heart rate is reduced than normal. And in exercise, white muscle fibers are active. They need more oxygen. They consume more oxygen. So you need more oxygen. So you breathe more, heart is beating more, and blood pressure also is increased. So I give this more scientific reason for this purpose, but which is very common, that during exercise, heart rate, respiration rate, blood pressure increases. And as against that, during asana, it should reduce than normal. That is what we must remember. So, asana does not mean exercise. That is clear now. But what does it mean? Asana is a Sanskrit word. And in the dictionary, it is given that asana means posture and existence. Dictionary gives different meanings, no, as usual. So, asana means two things, posture and existence. Of course, posture and existence, both of them indicate that there is nothing to be done. So there must be no movement. So asana word itself indicates that there is no movement. And asana is translated as posture. And if you think of posture also, you must think is posture is without movement. When you make the movement, it is not a posture. So whether asana or posture, there is no movement at all. So we can say steady posture is asana. And from this, Patanjali has given the definition of asana, which is very, very important for a yoga practitioner. We must remember this definition always when we practice asana. And definition is sthira sukham asanam. It's all in Sanskrit. I'll explain. Sthira means steady, sukham means comfortable, and asana means posture. So we can say steady and comfortable posture is asana. So this is the meaning of definition given by Patanjali 2500 years ago. And since then, people are practicing generations after generations. So this is the right way to practice asana. It must be steady, it must be comfortable also. If it is steady and not comfortable, it is not asana. If somebody is doing paschimottanasana, same asana we can say. He is not touching the head with the knees. When teacher may push his head down and hold him or tie it with some tape, rope or something, then it will be perfectly steady. But the practitioner is getting pain in the lower back because of the excessive pressure. So there is no comfort. So this is not asana. Don't do like this or don't teach like this. This forehead is not touching to the knee, but doesn't matter. It is not important. But steadiness is important, comfort is important. So asana must be comfortable to the practitioner. You also, when you are doing asanas, it must be comfortable. If it is not comfortable, it is overstrained, lot of pain, it is not asana. Don't do like that. Of course, during learning process, you have to put some pressure, it's okay. Because you have to learn something, your body is not ready to do, so you have to give some pressure. But regular practice of asanas must be perfectly steady, perfectly comfortable, then only it will give the proper result. So steady and comfortable posture is asana. Now definitely there is a question that when we are practicing asanas or make, there are different movements are there. What to do with those movements? You see, Asana is a posture without movement, that is perfectly right. But to attend that posture, the movements are essential. This is also correct. So we'll analyze the total process of attaining asana posture and maintaining all that. So we'll performing asana, any asana. I'm not considering any particular asana. I say any asana. How we perform? We take a pre-position, maybe sitting, standing, prone, supine, something like that. So from pre-position, step one, attaining the asana posture with movements. We make some movements and attain the posture, whatever the movement is there. So movement has to be there. And then only we can attain the posture. So this is the first step where we make some movements and attain the posture. Then we maintain the posture for some time. Maybe 10 seconds, 15 seconds, half minute, 1 minute, 5 minute, 10 minute, whatever it is. So we maintain the posture for certain period. This is the second step of asana. And then we release the posture, come to the pre-position with some movements. So definitely step 1 and step 3 movements are there. Step 2, no movements. So if you apply the definition to these steps, definition is steady and comfortable posture. So this steadiness is there only in step 2, not in step 1 and 3. So I can say step 2 is asana as per the definition. And step 1 and 3 is not asana. It is essential. We cannot avoid that. Movements are there. But they are not forming the part of asana. Asana is only whatever the period you make the body steady. That is asana. Movement part, step 1 and 3, even though it is essential, it is not asana as per the definition. So I give a very interesting example, which you must note actually. Suppose a person A, he is doing 15 asanas in 15 minutes. Let us understand. That is one asana in a minute. So he takes attaining that position half a minute, releasing half a minute, and he is doing one asana in 1 minute. That means he is attaining the posture and immediately releasing the posture. Likewise, he is doing 15 asanas in 15 minutes. So we can say maintenance time for asana is 0. For every asana, he attends in 30 seconds, releases in 30 seconds. Correct, 30 seconds. So 1 minute, one asana, 15 minutes, 15 asanas. Every day I am doing 15 asanas since many years, but like this. And now the person B, now he is doing 5 asanas in 15 minutes. Total time is same, but he is doing 5 asanas. He also spends half a minute for attaining the posture, half a minute for releasing the posture, but he maintains every asana for 2 minutes. So he is doing 5 asanas. See, every asana is maintaining for 2 minutes. Total time is 15 minutes only. But his maintenance time is 5 into 2, 10 minutes. Remaining 5 minutes is spending in movements. So A is doing 15 asanas in 15 minutes without maintenance time. And B is doing 5 asanas in 15 minutes. He maintains every asana for 2 minutes. So total maintenance time is 10 minutes. So this is the result. B is doing the asanas for 10 minutes. A is doing the asanas for 0 minutes. So I can say he is not doing the asanas at all. He will say, I am doing 15 asanas in 15 minutes every day since years together. But he will not get the proper results. He will get some results, no doubt. But B, when he is maintaining for 10 minutes at least, so you can say B is practicing asana for 10 minutes out of 15. So B will get better results. So considering this, we can come to the conclusion that we have to practice less number of asanas in a specified time period. You may be practicing for 15 minutes, half an hour, 1 hour, but don't go behind number of asanas. See, when we declare the syllabus of the course, people are asking us how many asanas you are going to teach. Of course, we are teaching 100 asanas, no doubt. But you are not supposed to practice all 100 asanas every day. You should select maybe 5, 6, 10, it's okay. So you must increase the maintenance time. In higher level practice, very high level, we teach some of the asanas to maintain for half an hour. So the students are practicing one asana every day. But they spend half an hour in one asana position. Of course, it needs a lot of practice and some techniques are there, but it can be done. So this is how. And now if you refer the Hatha Yoga, where all these different asanas are explained, Hatha Yoga says you are a master of an asana, provided you maintain the asana for 3 hours. So to maintain the asana for 3 hours, then you will become a master of the particular asana. That period is too long for us. But for half an hour, we have tried, we have taught, or we are also teaching students to maintain many of the asanas, may not be all, many of the asanas to maintain for half an hour. And the students are enjoying better the results. So this should be the aim. So whenever you practice asana, you try to maintain the asana for a certain period. How long to maintain? Clearance. Patanjali says, as long as it is comfortable. So you maintain the asana as long as it is comfortable and then release. If you lose the comfort and still continue to maintain the asana, it will have no use. Don't do it. Try to increase the comfort zone, comfort timing. And how to increase? Patanjali has given the solution to that also. But let us come before that. The movements which are essential for attaining the posture and releasing the posture, how they are, how they should be, that is very important. A steady and comfortable posture is asana. However, movements are essential to attain the posture. So the movements must be very, very slow. Because your final aim is to attain a steady and comfortable posture. So with fast movement, you cannot achieve that target. Suppose if you want to maintain this posture steadily, you are taking, making the movements from this one. So if you make a fast movement and go beyond the limit, again you make it fast, it will go down. So to make it steady, it is better to make a very slow movement, so you can make it steady at any position. So movements of all asanas must be very, very slow. Just like the slow motion pictures in TVs we see, particularly cricket match we see slow motion pictures. So asanas are to be practiced like that. So there will be no exertion, no consumption of extra oxygen. There will be relaxation in movements also. And so you can attain a steady posture which will remain comfortable for a longer time. Second point is the movements in asanas must be under control. Because fast movements exceed the limit of your joints. Controlled movements, you can make it within the limits. Because if you cross the limit, there will be pain. Pain is not expected in asanas. There must be comfort. So, controlled movements. Suppose if you get pain at a particular moment, you immediately should stop. Now these frozen shoulder people, for example, they cannot lift the hand like this. They can maybe lift up to this level only. So if it is under control, you will just observe at what stage they are having pain. If the pain is there, they will stop there only. So that is the right way to practice. See, in our regular healthy people also, when you are taking the positions, you must observe this. Because pain is strictly to be avoided. Pain should not be a result of practice of asana. So if pain is there, stop it before that. And then slowly increase your capacity step by step so that you can attain the final posture without pain, with comfort and for a longer time. And third important point, that breathing is to be controlled, correct type of breathing with the movements, because we are making slow movements, but during which the breathing is continued. We cannot stop the breath and make the movement. It's not advisable. And breathing, we have to make the movements of our lungs, particularly the chest. When you breathe in, chest is expanded. When you breathe out, chest is compressed. And there's a diaphragm between the chest and abdomen. Big muscle is there inside. So during inhalation, the diaphragm is pressed down. During exhalation, diaphragm is raised up. And third movement is abdominal muscles. When you breathe in, the muscles come out. When you breathe out, muscles go in. So these three movements are simultaneously going on while breathing. And in asanas, you are also making some movements. So these two movements, they must be supporting to each other and not contradictory to each other. That is the main important aspect. So you must control your breath. A very simple rule is there. When you bend forward, you should exhale. Because when you bend forward, you compress the chest, compress the abdomen and all that. So exhalation is a natural flow of air when you bend forward. And when you open the bend, you have to inhale. So these two principles you must remember, so you will come to know how to breathe in and out while performing any asana. Paschimottanasana, bending forward. So while bending forward, you exhale, don't inhale. And when you come up, you inhale, don't exhale. So we have to correlate this breathing also in other moments. So movement must be very, very slow. They must be perfect, under control, and they must be correlated with the proper breathing. These are the important aspects of the movements of asanas. Now let us come to the definition. Steady and comfortable posture is asana. Now steadiness and comfort must be in physical body first. All our muscles, body must be steady, muscles must be comfortable. So our body must be comfortable and steady, and mind also. Definition applies to mind also. If you are practicing asana, you have got number of thoughts in your mind. Maybe good or bad, that doesn't matter. But number of thoughts, then mind gets irritated. So there is no comfort to the mind. So body is steady and comfortable, but mind is not, so it is also not asana. So we have to make our mind also steady and comfortable. So steady means minimum thoughts. And comfortable means same thing. Minimum thoughts are there, the mind is always comfortable. If there are many thoughts, mind becomes irritated. And that is why normally yoga class starts with some prayer. Whatever the prayer may be. Maybe for any religion, that doesn't matter. Because prayer itself has got an effect of calming down the mind. And then only it is called prayer. So with certain prayer, we calm down our mind. And then we start practicing yoga. So that is very essential. And suppose when you are practicing at home or in another place, your mind is not steady, might have become very angry or something, under some emotions, maybe at a very sad condition, whatever it is. But then don't do any asanas that time. Unless your mind is calm and comfortable, don't do the asanas. That will not give the proper result. It may give some wrong results also. So your body also must be steady and comfortable, mind also must be steady and comfortable. That is the meaning of definition, sthira sukham asanam. And now the steadiness and comfort, they are interdependent. Then if body is not steady, it will not be comfortable. Or if body is not comfortable, it will not be steady. Because they are interdependent, each other. So we have to try from both. We have to try to make body also steady and mind and comfortable also. So don't overstrain the body. So you will not lose the comfort. So you can make it steady. If you lose the comfort by overstraining the body, then steadiness also will not be there. So this is a very important aspect before practicing asanas. Normally people are insisting to attain a final posture 100% perfect. They give more stress, more strain, they get some other help also. Some pillows, ropes, they are also used. That is not advisable actually in yoga. You should make it yourself, steady and comfortable. And to that limit only you should practice it, and then it will give the better result. That is why I told you that once you know all these basic principles, you can improve your practice of asanas in a better way. And this is supposed to be for every asana. Now, how to do it? Now, this is target given by Patanjali. This is to be attained. But how to attain? He is giving some techniques. And that is also very, very important. He gives a technique, Prayatna Shaithilya Ananta Samapatti Pranam. The earlier sutra is Sthira Sukham Asanam. Is PYS is Patanjali Yoga Sutra. 2 means chapter 2. And 47 is sutra number 47. So previous sutra was 46, definition of asana, Sthira Sukham Asanam. This is 47, the technique, Prayatna Shaithilya Ananta Samapatti Pranam. Prayatna is efforts. Shaithilya means relaxation. And Ananta is infinity. Samapatti is concentration. So these are the literally meaning of this sutra in English. But we have to interpret these sutras. There are two aspects. Prayatna Shaithilya is one aspect. Ananta Samapatti is another aspect. Which is to be implemented while practicing asanas. Now, what is relaxation with efforts? Very contraindicatory words. When we think of relaxation, we think of doing nothing. Then only relaxation is there. So there should be no effort for relaxation. That is what we think. Patanjali says you have to practice relaxation with efforts. So what is this effort? And what is the practice and how to do it? Now this indicates that during the posture of asana, you have attained a particular posture. You are making it steady for some time. And during that, you have to relax all the skeletal muscles. Skeletal muscle, I mean the muscles which are connected to all bones. Muscles of the hands, legs, fingers, all that. These are all called skeletal muscles because they are connected with skeletal bones. So these muscles we have to relax. And for relaxation, we have to do some efforts. Otherwise, when you lie down on the mat, you say, oh, I am relaxing. Or even chair also, you sit on the chair comfortable and say, I am relaxing, I am doing nothing. So when you do nothing, you say, I am relaxing. Here Patanjali says, you have to do something for relaxation. So what is that something? That something is purposefully relaxing each and every muscle of our body. If you have practiced Yoga Nidra, then you can understand this technique. In Yoga Nidra, practitioner is asked to relax each and every organ or each and every muscle of the body, starting from the right hand thumb. It is said in Yoga Nidra, just concentrate right hand thumb, relax it with closed eyes. Relax the index finger, middle finger, small finger around, right side, right hand, right leg, then left side, then bottom side, then front side, and then facial muscles, all sequence, big commentary is there. This commentary is about 7 to 8 minutes. That means you have to focus your mind with closed eyes to a particular organ of your body. And then with mind, you relax it. And it can be. If you just concentrate your mind on particular organ, you will find that muscles are strained. Then mind instructs to relax. And it will relax also. And you will experience the relaxation also. So this is called Prayatna Shaithilya. And this is to be practiced during the asana posture. So you are doing shoulder stand, Sravangasana. So legs up and supporting and all that. You are supported perfectly, steady now, comfortable also. So try to relax all the muscles. So muscles will be totally relaxed. And this is technique is called Prayatna Shaktila. So this we can understand that during the practice of asana, we have to relax the muscles. Now, we cannot spend 8 minutes or 9 minutes for relaxation, because that much we cannot maintain the asana. But whatever you are maintaining, maybe half a minute, 1 minute, 2 minutes. So attain a posture with very slow movements. Make it steady. Don't overstrain so it is comfortable. And then relax all the muscles. And you will feel still better. As I can say, you can enjoy the asana posture with this relaxation. It will take some time. First day you may relax for half a minute. 2-3 days you can go to 1 minute also. You can increase the time for 2 minutes, 3 minutes, 5 minutes. In our teacher training course, first week we asked to maintain the shoulder stand for 3 minutes. First day nobody can maintain. But 5th or 6th days, everybody can maintain. Comfortably. Comfort is there. Then next week, we ask them to maintain for 5 minutes. Again, same procedure. After some time, they start maintaining for 5 minutes. In advanced teacher training course, we ask to maintain them for 10 minutes. And they can. Of course, there is a slow process, step by step, we have to attain. But they can comfortably maintain it with relaxation. That is essential. If there is no relaxation, there is no prayatna shaithilya, maintenance for longer time is not possible. But with this, we can maintain up to half an hour also. Of course, it needs a lot of practice and some techniques are there. But this is a very good technique which can be implemented immediately, even if you are maintaining for 15 seconds. You attain a posture and relax your muscles. Try to relax whatever you can. So your body will be more comfortable. And you can extend the timing, maybe for 15 to 30 seconds, 1 minute and so on. So this is a very interesting recommendation by Patanjali. And this has written by Patanjali 2500 years ago. In those period, there were no modern development. Modern science is not there. But in India, the science has developed, science of yoga has developed like that they are giving such a nice explanation. The next part is Ananta Samapatti. Of course, this is a little bit difficult to understand also, right now at this level. Because for which you have to maintain the asana for a longer time. For 5-10 minutes, you cannot practice this Ananta Samapatti. Ananta is infinity. Infinity is, you can say, the universal consciousness. Because everything in the universe has got end. Which has got a birth, it has got an end. But universal consciousness, no birth, no end. It's an energy controlling the total universe. It's infinity, no end. So you have to concentrate on such thing. For a practical, we can see you can concentrate on the sky. Sky has no end. You can concentrate on the ocean. Ocean has no end, to us at least. So like this means you have to disconnect your mind from the body and take it to the infinity. That is the concept behind Ananta Samapatti. And to start with, you have to fully concentrate your mind on the body. Make very slow movement, attend a posture, make it steady, then relax all the muscles, fully concentrating on the body. But once you relax totally, then no concentration is required, no connection of mind to the body is required. So disconnect your mind from the body and take it to the infinity. That is Ananta Samapatti. So for a new beginner or a general practitioner, this is not possible. But one who practices to maintain asana for 20 minutes, 30 minutes, half an hour, 1 hour, then you can go for this fourth technique. But up to third one, this one, steady, comfortable and Ananta Samapatti. Sorry, Prayatna Shaithilya, relaxation. These are very important aspects for us. So you must follow all three, steadiness, comfort and relaxation. They are all supporting each other. When you relax better way, you will be more comfortable. And when you are more comfortable, you will be more steady. These all interdependent things are there. So these three points, we must always remember when you are practicing asanas. And try to implement all these three in your practice. Now the result. So next sutra, 48 number. So see, Patanjali is giving very short, so much of explanation about asana. He gives three sutras only. Virasukhamasanam first, Prayatna Shatila Ananta Samapatti is a technique, and third is a result. So everybody thinks, if you do like this, what is the result? I mean, if we follow these techniques, Patanjali's techniques, then what is the result? Patanjali is not talking about health and all that. We are practicing asanas particularly for maintaining of health or curing from diseases, something like that. And that we are getting the results. So those results are there. But as far as Patanjali, the original designer of yoga, is concerned, these are the byproducts or side effect, we can say. So good health and all that, but what you experience, freshness, increasing efficiency, all these things, these are side effects. Ultimate aim is tato dvandva nabhigata, that is the result of yoga. Let us understand this particular Sanskrit word. Tato means after that. That means after practicing the asanas as explained in previous sutras. So asana must be steady, asana must be comfortable, then you relax, prayatna shaitilya must be there, and then you take your mind to infinity. So if you practice the asana like this, then that is the meaning of tato. And dvandvan abhighata. Dvandvan means dualities. Life duality. Duality means two opposite things are there which come in together. Opposite things coming together. You see, heavy and light is opposite, coming together always. Hot and cold. We have to bear in our life, heavy and light, hot and cold. But these are physical dualities. Mental dualities are very important. So like and dislike. I like this thing, I don't like this thing. Everybody has got some likes and dislikes. This is a duality. I want this thing, I don't want this thing. That is also duality. I have this thing, I don't have this thing. That is also duality. And these dualities, they make our life miserable. So the like and dislike is there. Okay, whatever you get, whatever you like, then you are happy. And if you get whatever you don't like, that you are not happy. And most of the times the same thing happens. You have something, you don't have something. So you are thinking of whatever you don't have. You try to get it. You spend a lot of time, energy, money. And if you don't get it, again you will become sad. I want this thing, I don't want this thing. That is also duality. Again, same thing. If you don't get what you want, then you are again sad. And that's why we say life is full of miseries. Because of these dualities. We are struggling with the dualities, not getting the proper result and becoming sad. It makes our life miserable. So this is how the dualities affect our life. Patanjali says now here that practicing asanas like this, whatever I explained up till now, then dualities will not affect your life. It means there will be change in your mentality. So like and dislike. So there will be no like and dislike. Whatever you get, you will be happy. When there is no like and dislike, then you will be happy with everything, whatever you get. If you don't get, still you will be happy. So likewise, these dualities will not affect. So I have this thing, I don't have this thing, so I want to get it. But if duality is not there, no question. Whatever you have it. Whatever you don't have, no problem. You will be suffering nothing, so your life will be much more happier. So these dualities will not make any change in your life, but your life will be much comfortable. So the Patanjali is explaining the result as on mental level. Practice of asana is physical level. We have seen that you need to make some movements, attain a posture, maintain it and all that. It is all physical. So practice is totally physical and result is totally mental. So it will develop your mind, rather improve your mental situation. So you will be away from all these dualities. It includes different emotions also. And that is a good experience because we are teaching yoga since years together, maybe more than 50, 60 years. So there are people, they are regularly practicing yoga for years together. So we have observed these changes in these people. One person was very much angry. For some simple things, he was becoming angry. He also did not like that angriness, but he said, anger comes from me, I can't do it. I always become angry and start fighting every now and then. But he has practiced yoga, and after 1 year, we observed that his anger is totally gone. He has become very calm and quiet, now never becoming angry. So this is the change. And this is what is expected out of asanas. Even a person taking non-veg food or spicy food, he changes his habit. He's taking very vegetarian and very spicy, without spices. He likes it. So a lot of changes take place on mental level. And that makes the life more happy because of the practice of asana. This is the result of asanas. But if you need this result, if you want to get this result, you must practice as explained by Patanjali. If you practice as exercise, as we have seen in the beginning, 15 asanas, 15 minutes, this result is not there. Some physical result may be there. And even after practicing asanas like this, you are getting the other results also. This is explained by Patanjali as a target. Other results, whatever we have observed, that we get better health, we can improve the efficiency, physical efficiency, even mental efficiency. So all those results are there. There is no objection in that. Those we are experiencing actually. This we are not experiencing, but because we are not following properly. If you follow properly, you are also getting this experience, definitely. It will also improve your mental status, mental situation. And you will start behaving also properly. So we know Yamaniyam, Patanjali has given Yamaniyam in the beginning. How to follow, behave in the society. Ahimsa, Satya, Asteya, Brahmacharya, Parigraha. Then Niyam, Shaucha, Santosh, Tapasvadhyaya, Ishwara, Pranidhanani. When you understand Yamaniyam, you follow, it is very difficult to follow. But what I say, if you practice asana like this, you will automatically following Yamas and Niyamas. That means your behavior with yourself, your behavior with the society, your interactions in the society, they will also improve. Improve means in a better way. And you will be appreciated as a very good person in the society. You will behave properly, so everybody will appreciate. So this is a result of asanas, that is what I mean. So please be careful while practicing asanas in this particular technique. Physical results, you are going to get it, no problem. But in addition, you get mental results. And as you know, yoga is to control chitta vritti, that is controlling the functions of mind. Yogaha chitta vritti nirodha, that is aim of yoga, to control the functions of mind. So every technique, every practice in yoga leads to this aim of controlling the functions of mind. Yoga is there to control the mind. Of course, control is the initial stage, concentration is the advanced stage, and dissolution is the final stage of mind. But at least we can control our mind with the help of asanas also. So anyway, we are spending some time to practice asanas. So let us practice properly and get the all results. Not only health, not only physical, but it is mental health, I can call it. You can get a mental health also. Mental health, mental stability, mental peace. This also you can achieve during the same practice, provided you improve all the techniques. And techniques are not difficult. Patanjali has given the solution also. But you just remember and implement in the practice. and get the results. That is the total difference in practicing asanas. So this theory will definitely change the total aspect of asanas. How you look to the asanas, how you practice the asanas, total aspect will change because of this Patanjali's definitions and explanations. That is why I explain all these things. Hari Om.